Go
Okay,
ahead.
thank you. Good afternoon, everyone, and immense thanks to Mohit and Dilpreet. Unfortunately, Dilpreet is not with us today, and I wish all the best for his father health. And I convey thanks to AIUS for giving us me this platform to talk about. And today I'll be talking about the unhappy patients after phaco emulsification. Where did I go wrong? As you all know that the phaco is the gold standard for the phaco surgery, cataract surgery nowadays, and since its inception 1971, we have gone a long way. We have come a lot of innovations have come up, and phaco is the gold standard for cataract surgery nowadays. And now we are more talking about the quality phaco surgeries, and satisfaction has gone very high along with the expectation of the patient. So today I'll discuss how to make our patients happy, because if the patient is happy, that definitely will be happy. What are the reasons for the unhappiness? Obviously, the patient comes for the cataract surgery because of the visual gain. So if the visual gain is not there, if we have not done the proper visual axis alignment, maybe the eyewheel might not be there in the proper way, the biometry was not accurate, the position of eyewheel is not proper. So patient may complain, though obviously the patient will not be happy, and he'll complain. And sometimes we'll get the discomforts which are not related with the visual problems, but maybe related with ocular surface problems, irritations or discomforts or watering, or related with the eyewheel problems like dysphotopsias and positive or negative dysphotopsias and other halos or so on. So happiness comes when we do ethically good, when we do the best of surgical practices, we do proper surgical steps, and obviously we must try to gain the trust factor, because that the trust factor is lagging behind these days, and because of so much of the negativity towards our medical fraternity. So we have to fight with the trust factor also. We have to talk to the patients in the pre-op and post-op also. We have to explain everything. Even if the complication happens, we have to take the patient under confidence. So raising the trust factor is also very much needed for the to raise the happiness index. So now directly we'll come, because the time is short. So just a minute. So as you all know that in the modern surgery, the capsular axis is the biggest invention. Without capsular axis, we cannot think about doing good phacos. And thus, previously, when we started our phaco surgery, the size and shape were not important. But now, because we are using a lot of premium eyewheels, we are using toric eyewheels and multifocal eyewheels, where the centration is good. Even the monofocal abrasion-free eyewheels, if we to gain the best from the eyewheel, we must have the properly centrally placed eyewheel. The size and shape are very important. We must keep the size of axis around 5.5 to 5 millimeter, just to give the good grip of the eyewheel. If the size of axis is bigger, then obviously the chances of phaco PCO, early PCO formations are high. And if the size is less, then what happens, like in this video, you can see that I have release the phacophimosis, especially in the younger age where the capsular cells are very active, the fibrosis happens very fast. So you have to be cautious to maintain the proper capsular axis size to achieve the best outcomes. And if your axis is compromised, especially in the cases of mature cataract or intermittent cataract, where the capsular tone or the lenticular pressure is very high, so we may get Argentinian flag sign if we are not taking proper care of our pressure gradients. So if you are a standalone surgeon, my request is that convert the case, finish it with the SICS or ECC. Do not try to bring your ego in between. And because if you want to continue with this and without any vitreoretinal support, then you may end up in a major complications. And request is just to simply convert the phaco surgery to any simple way, and you can just remove the nucleus and leaving the eye in a better way. And if you want to continue, if you have a vitreoretinal backup, then if you wish to continue, then you have to be cautious to maintain the anti-chamber pressure gradient well, because any sudden decompression of anti-chamber might extend the axis, the torn axis towards the posterior capsule. And if for phaco surgeons, we have to be well versed with the different types of problems. Like if the patient has a subluxation of lenses, then you have to well versed with the endocapsular rings. You have to keep all these such gadgets standby. And if you doing, and you should try to learn these techniques from your seniors or what from where, and you can learn, try, you must learn, and you always try to maintain the inventory. And in cases of problems where we need to implant multi-piece, I will always keep the stock of multifocal IOL, because it is not advisable to implant the single piece IOL, because they are thicker in the sulcus, because they are thicker and they may create a lot of post-operative complications even in the secondary glaucoma in the later post-op period. As you all know, that Desmet's is very important, and it's an important structure to make the cornea in a dehydrated state. For the clarity of cornea, we need to have a good Desmet's membrane. And if your wound is not proper, if you are not make the proper size of the incision, then the chances of Desmet's tear are high. If you are using blunt instruments, blunt blades, then chances of this Desmet detachments are high. It is very important to recognize the Desmet, the detachments very early, and you try to sort it out. If you can, if you have a recognize the thing early, then obviously you can by just simply putting the gas, the air, or if needed, then the long standing gases can settle down. The help, you can take the help of those things to settle the Desmets early. Now, if the IOL is chipped, because what basically we want to achieve is the metropia, and that is not possible without the implantation. So implantation is necessary, and we need to have a clear corneal, clear IOLs to achieve a better vision. So to avoid the chipping, it happens, and it happens more with the hydrophilic implants. So try to learn proper loading techniques so that you can minimize the such complications. If the haptic is broken, you're implanting the any premium IOL like toric or multifocal, there is no choice. You have to expand the IOL, go with the fresh fresh implant. If the chip minor or if it is periphery, like in this case, you can see the chip is towards the periphery, you can leave the implant. Even if the chip is at the center and it is minor, you can leave the implant. And later on in the post-op period, you can assess the performance of IOL, and you can decide whether to go with the IOL or you have to explant it. PCR is the most common complication. None of the surgeon can say that I am not well versed with the posterior capsule complications. It happens with every hand. Any day it can happen. And the detection of PCR is very important. That is key to success. So detect PCR early. Do not try to do fishing. Do not try to go in the vitreous and pull it, because your traction can create peripheral retinal detachments, and later on you can get a lot of complications. So your minor complications might turn up in the land, major disasters. So for every eco surgeon, you must learn anterior vitrectomy, because this is the time of the need. You cannot mild to moderate complications you can handle by yourself, and must learn to recognize the vitreous, especially for the youngest. It is difficult to recognize sometimes the vitreous and the viscoelastics. So try to recognize, and you can even the take have the triamcinolone on other gadgets to highlight the vitreous. Again, the small pill is the main problem, especially in the older age senile patients. They have a fibrotic meiotic pupil. So you must have all type of expander devices. You must be well versed with the implantation of such devices and techniques. And if you want to continue with the even a moderate size, if you have that much of experience, always you can do it, but with the patience and by controlling your nerves. If there is a vitreous in the wound, so again, you have to recognize the vitreous properly, and then do vitrectomy properly, because any kind of vitreous strand present in the antechamber or in this wound can create a lot of traction in the peripheral part of the retina, and it can lead to, and even it can act as a nidus for the infection in the post-operative period. We may get endophthalmitis, chances are very high, and the traction can also lead to the posterior macular problems like cystoid macular edema and so on. So list is long, time is less. So learn good ethical practice, because good practices are necessary. You must learn the good steps of phacoemulsification to minimize the complications, to make the patients more happy. And because if you are doing surgery, you must have to face the complications. So, but the important thing is to recognize them early and accept them. And if you want to take the help of your any colleagues, like if there is a drop, then do not hesitate to contact with the vitreoretinal surgeon. Take the help of vitreoretinal surgeon so that you can achieve the best for the patient. And always communicate with the patient well. So in the post-op and pre-op period, like Mohit has said, that the communication and the counseling is very, very important in pre-operative cases. And Dr. Agna has explained that the way of keratometry, the head of posture of a keratometry can be your manual reading. So I think with this, I end, and I must convey again thanks to you for having me.
You can continue with the toric inputs for in place of Dr. Dilpreet.
Okay. So Mohit, because this was just told me, I think 10 or 15 minutes before the commencement of this program. So I just tried to, you know, gather some videos of my. So I one of a video which I finished this surgery in I think yesterday. I'll try to show this. And I kept two captions. So again, I'll leave. My which is the best eye for the toric? For the toric, where is the noise? Noise is coming.
We can hear your voice.
Okay. So, which is the best eye for toric? So, in short, any regular toricity, regular astigmatism is the best case for the toric. So, always do the topography well. If there is a regularity in the cornea, it may be in form of like, some ectasia, some corneal opacity, or you know, some sort of keratoconus patient. So if the astigmatism is irregular, if you are getting the boats, irregular boats eye pattern, then you know, patients are not good patients for the toric eye. So for the best toric, you need to select the regular astigmatism. Now, which marking system is the best? So there are a lot of studies have come up which have compared the digital marking systems and the CTM marking system, or even the we use the dumbbells or bobble markers. So if you are doing in a right way, any type of manual marking systems are equally good if you compare with the any digital systems like Varion or Calisto. If you compare, several studies have already proven that your manual systems are managed well, you can achieve that almost that the level of your marking goes almost same as the digital system. And as you all know that the digital systems are pretty expensive and you need to invest a huge amount for those systems. Now again, the size of the capsular axis. Size of capsular axis, as I said in my previous presentation, is very, very important because for a good grip, you need to have 5.5 to 5 millimeter of capsular axis so that your eye will get good grip all around, and the chances of rotations and chances of tilts would be quite less with a good grip of the capsular axis. Phaco technique, whatever is comfortable, it depends on the density of nuclear cataracts, it depends on the variety of cataracts, like if the patient has polar cataract, then you have to do accordingly. So technique doesn't depend, it depends on the variety of cataracts. You can see the good size of capsular axis, and you can see I'm polishing the posterior capsule with the hydrojet technique. Now, best OVD. Best OVD, especially in the toric, would be the high viscosity viscoelastic, especially the hyaluronic acid products, because you can easily pop, remove them, and very easily they come out, and because any amount of viscoelastics left behind the eyewill would be a reason for the early rotation of the eyewill. So the best OVD is high viscosity viscoelastics. So again, load the eyewill properly, inject the eyewill in the bag, and thorough removal of viscoelastic is essential. Always go behind the eyewill and thoroughly clean the visco behind the eyewill, and then go anteriorly and wash all OVDs from all corners of anterior chamber. And I think this is the one of the commonest reason for early rotation of toric eyewill. How much pressure we must keep before closing. So there should not be much of the pressure left in the ND chamber, because if you leave very tight eye, sudden decompression can lead the rotation of eyewill in early phase. So your pressure should be gentle. It should not be high, or it should not be too low. And after finalizing your when you just before finishing your surgery, before hydration, always press the eyewill posteriorly so that it sticks with the posterior capsule. So these are the few steps. If you take these steps properly, and if you consider those steps properly, definitely we can get the best outcome from the toric eyewills. Thank you very much. Over to you, Dr. Mohit.
Thank you.